It's a big pleasure to have this location. So we are kind of platzen aus den Nähten. We are kind of extending our suits. We have about 40 participants from the Berlin School tonight here, and it is always great to be in this impressive place. Fifth time, you're right. Another anniversary we are heading at. We are now in our 10th year of the Berlin School, which is kind of amazing. That we are growing. Fantastic participants from so many creative disciplines like advertising, media, journalism, PR, entertainment industries, design, architecture, communication technology, marketing. And the more I think about it and the more I have conversations with alumni, this has a real amazing effect, because nobody works in their silos anymore, but we are opening ourselves, and also to so many cultures around the world. We have now participants from 55 countries, and that is really amazing. We have a lot from Brazil, and we are discussing right now to rename the Berlin School to Berlin School. So let's see if we get that through in our next board meeting. We, from time to time, get crazy things through. Who is who attends the first time a president's lecture? Well, some people. Let me tell you, the focus of the Berlin School is actually to help great creatives to become great creative leaders with our teachings. And it really seems that there is a lot going on. Let me tell you one case, which is amongst some cases which kind of feel crazy and unbelievable. Ecuador, there was a president of the famous local soccer club called Barcelona. This man was in seventh heaven when he was appointed and loved by the whole community. There are pictures where you see his son, how proud the son is about his father. 4 years later, you look at the son, and the son is really concerned, because the father is the most hated person in the country. Why? Didn't win any championship. And for a year or so, the fans wanted to have him out of that position. He finally gave up, went for a surfing trip, injured himself, was hospitalized, read in the hospital about the Berlin School, and he said, well, I have my parents, they have this small agency here in the country. I'm gonna do the Berlin School. Now, he has not finished, but 2 years have passed, and he has won 23 Lions in Cannes, 2 Grand Prix. And I give you 2 examples, and I think Andy will like those. He announced a trip to Costa Rica to a new resort, and the resort was kind of a spectacular place. So he filled a plane, they flew to the resort, and then he had an interview with the people. How did they like it? Whether it was just awesome. All these waterfalls, the food, and the service, the friendliness, it was just out of the world. And for that price, we think we come here again. Then they told them, you know, you've not been to Costa Rica. Yeah? You still are in Ecuador. You never left the country. So that was, I mean, an idea for tourism. Yeah? He came up with, got him a Grand Prix in Cannes, I think a PR Grand Prix or something. And the other thing, imagine you're going to your supermarket where you shop every day, and you go in and you cannot find anything. So all is placed in a ridiculous way, like the cosmetics, it's shoe cream or stuff like that. And people are really embarrassed about this situation and complain. And at the cashier, you understand what was going on. It was an initiative to donate for Alzheimer. So this kind of pragmatic, intelligent stuff is done by him. And there's so many folks that went through the Berlin School who really helped changing things in their agency or in their enterprise, and we soon will explore it more and will communicate it more. So we have a brochure here. So for those that are not familiar with us, and the title is Leading Your Creative Revolution, and I'm really happy we have Mr. Sandoz, Andy, a rebel from the UK, who also has a serious job like running the D&AD, but beyond that, it's not all that serious, and it is really fresh and challenging what he does. And David Slocum, who runs our executive MBA, will now introduce Andy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. And I'll be brief because I want to hear Andy as much as you do. Although I will say thank you for the warm welcome, Matthias. It's wonderful to be back here. Andy started his career in creative industries as an illustrator, as a designer, as a game designer, as a 3D animator. He, perhaps more familiar to some, co-founded Work Club, which a couple of years ago, as you may know, majority stake of which was acquired by Havas, and now he is the creative director and innovation director at what is the Havas UK creative department.
That was all broadly correct.
Yes, it was all. And I say all of that as well as echoing Michael in that Andy is the president of the D&AD, but there's also a dark side to Andy. And I mention this because we talked a bit in the EMBA program about the dark sides of leadership. And the dark side doesn't just come from really amazing creative campaigns like the McLaren pit wall or the moving tattoo, but it comes from articles that you may have read like, be selfish, rude, and manipulative. And it comes from his opening, Hello, I'm Drunk. And finally, I will leave you with Andy and the full unabridged title to his talk, which may have drawn you here was the title, The Brief of Our Lives. But that should be followed by a colon and the words, I don't know. So with that, it's really my pleasure to introduce Andy, who, as a rebel, as a leader with a dark side, and ultimately as someone that we're really privileged to have here at the Berlin School, is going to talk to us about creative leadership.
If you took out the digital advertising part of that, that could have been the intro for Darth Vader. There's a really good carpet just there. Have you seen it roll? I really wanted to come on in that and just be rolled into the floor. That would have been a good entrance. Thank you very much for turning up That's always nice. And B, for such a grandiose and lovely intro. And also for being in English. I appreciate that very much. If I go too fast or say something, just stick your hand in the air and ask me to come around again. I'll happily come around again. I've got a couple of words of German, but Zali, in the back of my head, I think marmalade in German is a really interesting word. Is that true? No, there's orange marmalade. I seem to remember that, but the one I really like is Weltschmerz. It's my favorite word in the world, and I just try and picture what this looks like, this word. And a friend of mine, we had a Pinterest board of pictures that we thought summed up Weltschmerz. He is German, which helped, you know. It's kind of. But so, again, thank you for allowing me to talk in English. Otherwise, I could say the word Weltschmerz a few times and I'd be done. Despite that intro, I'm not actually drunk. In fact, I gave up drinking, which was an interesting experiment about a year and a half ago, and it fascinates people. I don't know, you say, they're like, did you have to? What is wrong with you? Did you have a problem? Like that is really, it's a good opener. When I used to drink, I'd have awful ideas, like just goddamn awful. And obviously, I didn't realize till the next day because I was drunk, and that's how it works. But I would start to think, why? Like, what's going on? And obviously, my brain is just misfiring. And it's because you have no taste when you're drunk. You have no sensitivity of the context of what you're doing. You have no inhibitors that check how society would respond to what you're saying. And so your ideas are fundamentally out of context, probably quite entertaining, but totally out of context. But what I realized in the same process is when I was hungover, I had excellent ideas. Like really, really fucking good ones. Like I would wake up and go, ow, oof, ow, God, ow. And hangover and good ideas. And it would happen regularly. To the point you might question, why don't I keep drinking? Not a sustainable future. So again, I would think about what the hell is going on for me to have good ideas hungover and awful ideas drunk, and then, you know, average ideas normal. And I got to this thought that my brain was just making mistakes. And when it was drunk, it would make big mistakes. But when it was hungover, it wasn't really drunk. It was just a bit tired and a little bit sort of drunk. Therefore, it would go for a metaphor or something in my brain, and it would miss. And so it would come two over, if that was possible, if you run with me, to the metaphor, which means it was still contextually relevant, but weird, which is all creativity is. It's like it's the obvious choice to the left of it. And so my brain was acting creatively because it was misfiring and making a mistake and giving me a reference that I hadn't worked out yet, but my brain knew. I've quite often, that's useful, quite often been convinced that my brain is smarter than I am and is faster, you know. There we go. So back on. So hopefully I've convinced you that I'm sober by that thinking, but I spend too much time thinking about my own brain, I think. And normally about this time I ask, are there any brain surgeons or actual real scientists in? And if you are, can you leave? Because otherwise I will be exposed as some kind of pop science fraud in this process. There's a really lovely chair right there, if anyone's standing up back there, by the way. Nice and comfy, you're a bit close. I might sit on your knee. Anyway, so the thing with this brain, what I learned about it listening to a few people is the brain is just white matter and gray matter. And the gray matter is like where stuff is kept. And the white matter is what gets to the stuff. So gray matter buildings, white matter roads. And apparently, one man said this and I took it as gospel, the more white matter you have, the more creative you are. Because there's more highways to the memories and the storing and the chunks that you have in your ideas to get to things. Because you make more references if you have more of these highways. Now, if that is true, and I didn't make this up, this is a proper scientist who came out with all this kind of stuff, not just me. That makes me think when I'm hungover that my brain is slightly just taking the wrong road. Now, again, I have no idea if this is true or not, but it made a lot of sense to me because I kept having these good ideas where my brain was making mistakes. And so it taught me something. So it taught me this, that creativity is just connecting things. It's like apparently our brain, one of our successes is we can hold two ideas in our head at any one time, which means that you can hold an idea about marmalade and an idea about fast cars and put them together and come out with a new idea. And that's the premise of human creativity. So I said this, creativity is just connecting things. Fortunately, when I Googled it, I found out Steve Jobs also said it, which is me fucked, because it'll always be his quote. But it's true, whenever I say it, it's just about putting two ideas together. It's not that complicated when you think about it. It's just about your brain connecting things. Thank you. So learning number one in this, mistakes are really important in our game. So you can get mistakes many, many ways, but certainly being hungover will give you those mistakes. And I think the concept of failing has been quite big in creative industries for a while. I have a different take on it. We have Don't Fuck It Up written really big in our office, partly because it's fun to say, but in truth is what it tells you is have something fuck-upable in your work, but don't let it fuck up, because then it's just wrong. And so for me, like, I don't want failure. It's okay to fail, but try really hard not to. But mistakes are really important in the creative process. The errors and the mistakes that you make when you're having ideas, that is the creative process. Learning number two, then, what you put in your brain matters. So if you put alcohol in your brain, it goes a bit nutso. You know that. And then there's a benefit I found in being hungover. But then if you put all kinds of other things in your brain as well, you can put all kinds of information, references, other people's ideas, other people's works, cultural provocations. I think both of the examples that, Michael, you referenced were human-centric. This creative, in both, he understood how people felt to change how people behaved. And so just understanding and empathy for your target audience, which is a rare thing in advertising, put that into your brain and that helps. So what you put in your brain matters. If you put LSD in your brain, I've never tried, but I imagine that's quite interesting what will come out of your brain at that point. The main reason I'm telling you is because it was synthesized by Sandoz Labs, which is my surname. So it's a nice way of saying, hey, that's my name, introduce myself. I always like this, that's a healthy decision. You know, maybe I have that on my card. Synthesized, like the guy that synthesized this didn't know what he'd done. If you look it up on Wikipedia, there's a guy working at Sandoz Labs, basically synthesized LSD, took a bit, got on his bicycle, and then fell off and had a bit of a trip on his way home. No idea what he'd done. And it's a nice story. Anyway, that's my name, Sandoz, Andy Sandoz, hello. I thought I'd introduce myself in the middle of the talk. So it's all been said, really. I was an entrepreneur, startup-y, digital type guy, and now I find myself the ECD of a network agency, which is an interesting river, I think, you know. And people say things like, oh, how did you plan your career? I was like, I didn't plan a career. I got in a river, and the river was small, and then it got bigger, and it sped up, and it flows. And I think that's a creative journey, right? You just get in the water, and you go. And so that's where I am today. The reason I've got a glass floating in the background, which you can't really see because of the lights, is I do actually do some work other than this, that we do actually make stuff. And the last project we made was for Ballantine's Whiskey, and we created a glass that works in microgravity. Because we looked at all the big problems in the world that we could solve, the really important social problems, and we decided to make it easy to drink whiskey in space. But what was beautiful, and there's nice advertising films, but it's a different way of marketing. Well, rather than tell a Ballantine story, we created an object and told an advertising story around the object. So it's just an interesting experiment in how to do marketing. But the object is legitimate. You know, it's a beautiful piece of design. I can say that because I didn't design it. We went out to someone who knows what they're doing in space and microgravity to work with. But it's really thought through. Like the cold touch mouth clip is apparently astronauts get all bummed out that they can't have glass, because emotionally that's a different drinking experience, because we're used to drinking out of china and glass and things that are cold. plastic is warm. Emotionally, not good for these astronauts, thousands and thousands and thousands of miles away from home. You know, the base is metallic, so you can stick it to the space station walls, because otherwise it would just float around and hit you in the head all the time. The it's got a docking system underneath, because you can't pour whiskey, you have to pump it, because obviously you can't pour at all, you know. And then it has this helix inside, fundamentally a straw, and these lovely spiral ribs with the liquid holds to. So it's a lovely piece of proper product design from an advertising agency that we then made a load of advertising about. I went on a bit. I didn't want to really show you my work. That wasn't the point of it. But I just wanted to show you that I do work. I'm also the president of D&AD, which is a wonderful honor. I've been around D&AD for 5 or 6 years doing talks and helping sort of modernize the product. And really my big thing for them is connecting up awards and education. And that's what I really believe in, is if you work with a not-for-profit like this, you connect the people who can win awards with the people who want to win them, and you teach each other how to do it. Judging Week for us is now huge, so it's coming up in April 2016. If you were thinking of visiting London, I am your travel agent. The time to come is in April, towards the end for Judging Week. All the work is on show. All the judges are in town. Loads of parties, loads of hangovers, loads of good ideas. It all looks a bit like that, looks a bit like this, really. And this is that point I wanted to tell you about, really, this win one, teach one mentality. I think creative leadership isn't about you, it's about all the other people in your department that you're trying to get to be better than you. And it's about teaching them how to do it better than you could do it, so you could get the hell out of the way and have an easy life. That's the way I think about it. Like, if you don't need me, I'll just hold on and we'll all go together. And so really, this win one, teach one mentality is through our company, it's through Work Club, it's through Havas, and it's through the heart of D&AD. And there's a lot, look, I did this a while ago now. There's a lot of debate about the value of awards at the moment. I should have just shown you this before when I was asked this question, but if you enter awards, right, you get happy. Happy's good, right? No one's gonna say, I don't wanna be happy. You win an award, you get happy. You get promoted, the business gets new business, and the network gets credit. Okay, right? But if you go for not-for-profits, what we try and do is we take the knowledge from the awards and turn it into content. We turn it into education, much like you do here. And then we take initiatives like the White Pencil, which we did 3 or 4 years ago as a catalyst for awards for good. We started to say, well, look at this industry and the influence it can have, but it's not wielding that influence in the right direction. So something like the White Pencil is meant to be a catalyst to that, to try and make the advertising industry think about the impact it can have on the world. And then we create curriculums of learning, better work for all. You've got a nice loop, help the industry, raise the floor, do the awards, help the industry, do the awards, help the industry. It's all for good. That's my pitch. Enter D&AD and you enter your own future. I'll get off the pitch. So the reason I really walk around a lot, this up band is going to get lots of steps. The reason the talk is called I Don't Know is because, like, you know, I'm like, hey, come and do a talk. I'm supposed to tell you something. Like, I'm some kind of expert. I don't trust experts. I don't trust anyone who says they're an expert. How can you be an expert? That says you know everything. Like, definitely don't trust anyone that says hashtag expert. Like, my God, like, as soon as I see that on Twitter, I'm like, unfollow, can't deal with that. Because I'm going to end up in an argument with that person, because I'm going to try and poke holes in their point of view, because I don't believe anyone can be an expert. It's too complicated. There's too much stuff out there. It's much more humble to say, hey, man, I'm just trying. I'm just trying to do something. I'm making mistakes. I'm experimenting. I'm just trying to do things. So when I say I don't know, mostly I mean it. And when I get a new brief, that's what I look like. I'm like, oh, man, this is hard. I've no idea how to solve this problem. That's the fun bit. The best idea that I've never sold is I tried to sell McDonald's a high five for $1. So you go into McDonald's and you can say, I'll have this meal for $4, or I'll have this meal for $5 and a high five, same meal. To try and see if the people would pay an extra dollar just to get a high five off the person behind the counter. I reckon they would, because you're going to come out emotionally like, ooh, high five with your meal. And I couldn't get the client to run it. And I'm convinced that fun little ideas like that, that make people happy, and where obviously, where does that dollar go? It needs to go to charity. It can't go in Mr. McDonald's back pocket, can it? But those kind of experiments and those kind of fun ideas, that's what we need to be playing with. That's kind of the stuff that, so like, I don't know because it never ran, but that's, anyway. So I'm not alone, right? This guy is Charlie Munger, and he's Warren Buffett's right-hand man. He's 91. Mostly what I like about this guy is if you gave me a pen and said, draw a picture of a 91-year-old, very, very rich American, that's what I would draw. I would draw Charlie Munger. But he says, and this is about the economic markets, this is a man, if there ever were an expert about how economic markets did work, he could claim it. He says, if you find it puzzling, your brain is working correctly. I love that. That just says, if it's difficult, you're working. And I say that with all the creatives I work with now, like when they're struggling. I say, if it was easy, anyone would do it. That fight, that trial, and that passion to come up with a dumb high five or whatever it is that you're trying to come up with that will change the game, that's difficult. If it's puzzling, your brain is working correctly. So no answers from me. Hopefully a bit of confidence. Let's go back to drugs. This, I think, is my favorite piece of copywriting. Timothy Leary, 1967. Off his face, I'll be polite. There's another expression in British, you may know in English. He wrote, turn on, tune in, drop out. I think that's a fantastic piece of copywriting. Turn on to yourself, who you are, meaningfulness about your place in the world. Tune in to all the other people doing the same thing and then drop out of the system. Powerful, powerful words. But as a creative, I get it. Think about you and what you think and the subjectivity you see and your thoughts and passions. Look around you at all the people and do not do what the man says. Really is very, very, very good advice. How many years later? 40, 50, 40 something? Wasn't maths for me. Sometime later, he also said, turn on, boot up, jack in, which is nowhere near as good copywriting. However, if you think of the difference between those two dates being about 23 years of taking LSD every day, the fact that he could still fucking write is impressive, if you ask me. But what he was saying with turn on, boot up, jack in is the PC, the computer, is the LSD of the 90s. So let's go back and say what you put in your brain matters. This is a guy that used to say you put LSD in your brain and it matters. In the 90s, he's saying put computers, put technology in your brain and you will have different ideas. Technology will give you the trip, not LSD. I've always loved that thought. Thank you very much. This is my other hero. If you Google nothing out of this talk other than this guy, this is a success for me. If you don't know Richard Feynman's work, please Google him. I just think he's fucking amazing. And I really want to interview him for D&AD, but he's dead. So I haven't figured out how to do that yet. He was a scientist and a theoretical physicist, which is an amazing job, right? You don't practically do anything. You just sit around thinking about physics. Amazing. And he would say things like, he said, I explained it once, they didn't understand it. I explained it twice, they didn't understand it. I explained it a third time, and finally I understood it. You know, he had this lovely kind of sense of his own ability to teach and talk, and his lectures are amazing, and he talks about the beauty of flowers next to the kind of metaphysics of it all. But he also said this, if you think you understand quantum mechanics, you don't understand quantum mechanics, which I love. That this is a guy that when the space shuttle broke, they phoned him up and he fixed it. Like this was the smartest man in America and he was able to operate with this humility that said, I haven't learned anything yet, I'm still learning. And he's a brilliant creative leader and a scientist to boot, which I just think is wonderful. And this is my dear old dad and my son. And I was, my dad was a professor of engineering and I was, and my brother is a doctorate of some kind of cybernetic-y stuff. And I painted, like I was like, not having any of that. Like any good son should do, I did the other thing. And I was at Christmas, they have these Christmas lectures, quite science lectures, from the Royal Institution in the UK, where they sort of, they try and make it easy to understand a scientific theory. And I was watching it with my brother and my father, and it was so hard. Like I was on the tip of my seat watching, I was sitting there like this, trying to concentrate. I had my phone out, I was Googling every third word the man said, and I couldn't make a head nor tail of this thing. And I was getting really stressy at the TV because this is supposed to be easy. Kids were supposed to watch this and understand it. And I've looked over at my dad, and my dad's like, quite relaxed. It doesn't look that relaxed, maybe more like that. And my brother's the same, totally relaxed, not caring. This is easy. I understand all this. And I'm looking at the TV, and I'm just getting angrier and angrier. And I'm like, finally, I've gone, oh, fuck this. And they're like, what's wrong? And I'm like, I can't understand it. Can't understand a word of it. I'm getting really annoyed. Look at you, like it's someone's talking to you about like vegetables or something. And they're like, my brother leans in, he looks at me and he goes, I don't understand it. I'm like, what? And he goes, I don't understand a word of it. I'm like, but he goes, it doesn't matter. And I was like, hey, because I'm trying so hard to be intelligent. I'm trying so hard to crack it and understand it. My brother doesn't care. And he's supposed to be the smart one in the family. And then my dad looks at me, and he just, like the best, the only, like if this was the only thing he ever did in his whole entire, he did many things, but if this was the only thing he did, it was good enough for me. He just said to me, you're not supposed to understand it. He said, there's only four people in the world that probably understand this. You're not supposed to. And I was like, it was like the weight's coming off. And suddenly I was like, wow, let's get a beer out. And just because it's suddenly like I've just all that kind of pressure to know the answer, all that pressure to understand bloody quantum mechanics or whatever, which I couldn't do, off. No one bloody understands it. No one knows what they're doing. They're all making it up. Thank you. Learning three. It's okay not to know the answer. Now, this is a major, major learning for me in my career. There's so much pressure to know the answer. So much people, especially as a creative, they're looking at you, come on, and you're like, oh, fuck, I haven't got it. I haven't cracked it. I don't think one person has the answer. It's too hard. You must collaborate with others. You must share. And to collaborate, you need to put it out there and say, I do not know. But I'm willing to try. I'm willing to explore. I'm willing to experiment. But it's okay to say, I do not know. And I think this. I think we're a better industry if we admit difficulties rather than we bluster and put hashtags on everything we pretend we understand. So it's okay not to know the answer, thank you. If that's working for you, I really could do it for myself. It's just me. It's just me, you know, thank you very much. This is my father's business. And he set up a business in the 80s that would go into factories, look at how the factory worked, create a piece of software about how the factory worked, and then simulated where the factory would go wrong, and then fix it before it happened, which is kind of time travel and science fiction. And obviously, when he told me this when I was younger, I was like, whatever, sounds boring. But then I spent about a week in his office earlier this year at home doing some stuff, staring at this plaque on the wall, and suddenly just went, fuck me, that's a cool name. I'd never seen the name. Like, it's been around for 30-odd years in my life. I'd never seen predictive control. It's so evil, this name. It's like something out of some kind of sci-fi movie where I've rung the doorbell of predictive control and they're going to go and fuck with my head when I go in there. And I was like, this is such a cool name. And then I thought about what he did was time travel. And I was like, man, you were cool. And he's looking at me going, like that, it took you this long to realize? Thank you. And what he was doing was playing with science fiction, playing with, he was doing pattern recognition, he was doing data, actually, which, you know, is the holy grail right now. The data will tell us what to do, and I think we'll get to that. But this science fiction thing, this predictive, should do predictive control. I've always wanted to do that with a mic, it works quite well, actually. This is William Gibson. Read Neuromancer if you've never read Neuromancer. It's a seminal book from the 80s about science fiction. And this is the guy that invented the term cyberspace. It wasn't Cannes Lions, Yeah, it was William Gibson. And listen to this description. A consensual hallucination experienced daily by billions of legitimate operators in every nation. Sounds like the internet. The internet wasn't around when he wrote that. You know, this crazy kind of proposition of the future. And it's his fault. It's science fiction's fault, our strange relationship with technology at the moment. Because Neuromancer was the influence, thank you, for The Matrix. Although you wouldn't know from reading the book. And what it gave us a semiotic of technology that looks like this. We have created a visual world of technology that's scary as fuck. That is this kind of mad, futuristic thing that's going to come and destroy humanity. Like, you look around, whether it's Deus Ex Machina, if you've seen that film, which I love that film, the perfect ending. I won't go any further than that. But, you know, the sense of that this is what technology looks like, and that technology is some kind of machine that will come destroy us. Now, do you know what? Weirdly, that may actually be true. But, you know, we're going to find out in about the next 20 or 30 years, I think, where that path goes. But until then, this isn't actually what technology looks like. This is what technology looks like. So, the brief for this car is a design triumph in my book, right? So Google is sitting there going, we're going to make a car with no driver. That's pretty scary. Can you make the car look like it couldn't possibly kill someone if it tried? That's what I think the brief was for this car. It's a little clown car. You get in it and you drive around, you got your knees up behind your ear. So you don't drive, you just got your knees up, you know. And so I think the whole design is a piece of communication in saying friendly. Automated car friendly, robot friendly. I also like to imagine how it decides it's had enough or if it's going to crash. What I think it does is it implodes with you in it and just crushes you, and you're gone. And robot car says, and then it's gone like in dust. In fact, if I still had my 3D animation skills, I would animate that right now. But I think it's a wonderful piece of design, and I think it's a wonderful piece of technology, and it's pretty friendly. But then if you've read up on the trolley project, the trolley project is this project that says, it's an old philosophical question, like there's a train running down the tracks. And so train coming this way, and you're here and you've got the switch, right? So you can make the train go left or the train go right, your choice. The train is currently going left. Along that path are four people. They will get hit by the train and they will die. If you switch it, they will live. But over here is one person. And they will die. What do you do? That's a hard one. Because you think, well, I'll switch it because then only one person dies. But then it's your fault. Because the four people, you go, I didn't drive the train. So there's this whole ethical quandary around that switch that is really hard to understand. And then multiply that by a billion of that car on the road trying to work out the choices it's going to make about collisions and choices and ethics. And actually, you are not in control of what that car will do. That car will make choices based on data about your life. No wonder it's a minefield, proper scary. Interesting, nonetheless, but this is not what technology looks like. This is what technology looks like. Two of the most influential, richest men on the planet. I always feel like, I generally make a joke about if I was in the playground with them at high school, I wouldn't be very frightened of them. But then I think they're going to appear from somewhere and a bag's going to get on my head and I'm going to get carted over to Google and roughed up for saying it. But look, these are just a couple of smart guys, admittedly, very smart, in the right place, you know, to take advantage of the opportunities that were presented to them with the spirit and the bravery and the idea of AdWords and spiders and cataloging the web and then just the power of Google to keep running and doing stuff. They're just guys who were not afraid of technology. They're just two normal Joes who like wear their underpants in the morning like everybody else. They probably even got wedgied. Yes, thank you. So what they understand is that this technology, this scary kind of ethereal, semiotic kind of monster of technology is just a tool to make ideas happen. That's it. And obviously, really good ideas that pay a lot of money if you're those guys. But mostly from our point of view, from the advertising industry, design industry, creative industry's point of view, disruptive ideas. What I like about the future is this phrase called the unknown unknowns. So there is the known unknowns. So that's the shit we know we don't know. And I'm like, I've got loads of that. But then there's the unknown unknowns. Right? So the known unknowns are kind of scary because I feel like stupid because I don't know them and someone else does. The unknown unknowns, nobody knows. Like, no one knows what's going to happen there. And when I think about technology, it's not that hard to think there's probably a lot of this going to happen. Like, what about dark matter? Discover what that is, and then all that comes in, or the Hadron Collider turns up. So, I don't know, someone just invents something in their bedroom that changes the game. There's these great stories. There's a guy in Sweden who split the atom in his shed. You know, there was another guy trying to do it in his kitchen. You know, this sense of remixing, just lunacy. Yeah, I'm going to split the atom in my own house. But this sense of amazing future from technology that we can't predict what's going to happen. It's so exciting. Like, if you think about Airbnb, Airbnb is an amazingly simple idea, a hotel without hotels. Like, that's lunacy. That'll never work. Bloody does. But also it creates jobs because someone else comes along and says, all those people who are now running hotels, they don't want to run hotels. I'll run the hotels for them. And loads of little jobs. But Uber's the same. A taxi rank without taxis. But these are insane little twists of ideas. This disruption is fantastic to play with. Thank you. And this is a music writer called Paul Morley. And the writing is by Brian Eno, who maybe you would know. Really amazing creative talent. But he said, I was talking to the writer Paul Morley recently about the music form called dubstep. Does dubstep big in Berlin? You would know? Some people's like, what? And other people's like, yeah, man. So that tells you. But at last, Paul Morley says, I've heard a form of music I really don't understand. I don't understand who makes it, why they're doing it, and who's listening to it. That's what I've been waiting for. So when I think of the spirit that I need as a creative director, it's that. And the spirit that frustrates me most in other creatives is the opposite of that. Because you're supposed to be a creative person. You're supposed to be curious. And so why would you not engage with something that you don't understand? Fear. That can be laziness. There's probably a couple of others, but mostly they're not good qualities. If it's fear, then we need to take that away. And this is what happens with technology. I watch people do it. You say, oh, have you seen that thing on blah, blah, blah? And they go, oh, it's not for me. And they do this. Like someone's pointing a gun at them. Their body language. And I'm like, it's just technology. Just go play. And so this is why I like this. This is what I've been waiting for. Thank you, mate. So ask yourself, when you see something you don't understand, what is it? Can it do this? You know, if it gives you an electric shock, don't do it again. And this is just experimentation. This is scientific method. Go right back to God knows Plato or one of those dudes way back when. Can you call Plato a dude? That probably puts me in a certain bracket, doesn't it, I think, of not really understanding it. But the point is that if you approach something you do not understand with vigor and curiosity, you will experiment with that thing and try things that have not been done before. You will reach the unknown unknowns because you're not repeating what has been done in the past. But if you do not experiment, you won't do it. And we're not an industry famed for experimentation. Thank you, mate. So learning four. Understanding technology on any level changes the type of idea you can have. So I've phrased this specifically this way to say, if you engage with technology on a level of interest, any level of interest, it doesn't just change how you push ideas out into the world. Oh, I will push this idea out on Twitter. It changes the type of idea you can have because you will understand the behavioral sciences in Twitter that influence the idea in the first place, or you will understand how the API can actually elevate an interaction differently than you might have wanted in your advertising, or you will understand why hoverboards are cool or not and use those in your stories. So for me, any level of technology understanding is a weapon in creativity because it puts new things in your brain. Remember point one. What was it? That's point two. Point one was mistakes. Point two, what you put in your brain matters. Put technology in your brain and it matters. Thank you, mate. It makes the impossible possible. These are the ideas that I like. I was thinking about one. We were talking about architecture. I'll get to that one in a sec, but on the way over. When I was in Shanghai a couple of years ago, someone told me that there was this amazing building going up. Famous architect, amazing building, really difficult to design and build. It's going up really slowly. Just around the corner, this is so brilliantly Chinese, there was an exact copy going up way faster. And I just loved it that this building that was kind of the pinnacle of this person's great career was being ripped off faster than they can get it. So what matters? Which one's first? The rip-off is first. And I just thought it's being remixed faster than the original. That's impossible, but amazing. And that's the culture we live in. If you look at the way the music industry releases music, it releases music to be remixed, sampled, taken, twisted, and returned. We can do the same with our creativity. We can remix and return it back into culture. I forget the name of this artist, excuse me. Dutch artist, begins with V, I believe. He just does clouds indoors. They're really lovely. And I'm just kind of like, hey, that's weird. And it's just beautiful. Like, clouds don't live indoors. My brain is struggling. It's wonderful. This is a man who's about 55, and he's called Aubrey de Grey, which is a wonderful British name, Aubrey de Grey. I don't think it is his name, but he is trying to reverse aging. So he has a £1 million prize for someone who can show stopping aging in mice. It's called the Methuselah Mouse Prize. And he believes that he can make us immortal and maybe immortal in his lifetime. He's trying really hard. What I like about him is he's 55, but he's made himself look like he's 155, but really fucking healthy. Which is really on brand if you think about it. He's like a sprightly Gandalf. Thank you. This is my favorite idea of the whole of last year. This tells me everything about ideas that I need to know. In Melbourne, there was a park where the trees were getting diseased. And so someone in the council said, well, let's give the trees email addresses. So people can write to us and tell us when that tree is diseased. So I would walk through that park every day and this tree would be tree number 71, it's got some disease, and I would email it. Say, hey, there's some disease on this, can you come look after the tree? Nice civic use of technology that, I like it already. You know, I like a park and a council and things like that. But humans are idiots. And you cannot account for this. What the humans did was wrote love letters to trees. Dear tree, I'm so sorry you're going to die soon. It makes me sad when the trucks damage your low-hanging branches. Are you as tired of all this construction work as we are? You know, like, I would never have sat in a room and say, hey, you know what, if we give emails to trees, someone will write them love letters. I can't predict that. Like, you think about data recognition. I talked about what my father did with data, all that pattern recognition. No data in the world will tell you to do that. Like, it makes no sense. It's the human spirit that says, hey, fuck it, I'm going to write a love letter to a tree. And that tells you a lot about the world where we're in that's all about data and what's happened before and trying to predict the future. That is fortune telling. And if you read your stars in the newspaper regularly, you'll know that's pretty much snake oil. So you've got to be careful with all this data telling you what to do. There's huge value in it. But also at the end of the day, you've got to write love letters to trees. NASA emails Spanner 2 space station. My brain just goes, what? Robots educated in human pain thresholds by repeatedly punching researchers. So the only way you could teach a robot where the pain thresholds were was if you let the robot punch you, and the robot could go, oh, okay. Thank you. The bioprinter deposits ultra-thin layers of living cells upon each other following a precise geometrical pattern that matches the heart valve. It's a human 3D printed heart valve. It's just like, whoa, this is not gonna end well. I love this too. So if you think about creative problem solving, So rhinos being hunted to extinction for the qualities of their horn, and rhino beer, weirdly, out of their horn. And so what would the advertising industry do to solve this? We would make an emotive film about the rhino trying to hit someone in the heart, you know, and say, we have to stop, and we'd all sign a petition and nothing would change. Whereas what these guys do, these technical dudes, they have tried to synthesize the DNA of a rhino horn, make fake rhino horn, flood the market with it, so no one knows if they're buying fake or real rhino horn, and make fake rhino horn beer. And so they've just, I don't know, they've just killed the market. They haven't even gone near rhinos or advertising or storytelling. They've said, well, let's make fake rhino horn. Now, it takes a particular kind of brain to say, let's make fake rhino horn. Because the next question is, how the fuck do we make fake rhino horn? And then you have to say, I do not know. But I bet somebody else there does. And then you've got to go find them. It's a bit like, sorry, this is gross flattery. Hey, let's make a glass for space. How do we make a glass for space? I don't really know. Let's go and talk to someone. And it's the same process. And it's that sense of being free to say, well, I don't know, but someone out there does, and collaborating about it. But I love that creative solution, that anything is possible, different way of solving the problem, way smarter than any piece of media that's going to make me cry a solution. That is a lung on a chip. I don't even know how that fucking works. Like, my brain just stops. I look at it and go, it's a lung on a chip. Why is it on a chip? What is that? It's like an artificial body part that you can infect with diseases. I don't know why it's on. I don't know. I haven't even researched it properly. I just look at the picture and I go, phew. And so it sits in my brain as something to use, because one day I'm going to go, hey, why don't we put a lung on a chip? And someone's going to go, well, how the fuck do we do that? And I'm going to go, I don't know, but I know a man who does. And I'll phone this dude up. This is a water bottle. Which isn't great, right? Because these water bottles, thankfully we haven't got any, are killing the planet, all these plastic bottles everywhere. This one is edible. So you just kind of go, drop it into your mouth. It's plant extract as a bottle. That's the kind of creativity we need going forward that says, I don't need the bottle, I'll redesign it, I'll reimagine it. This man wants to plant 1 billion trees at a time. Talk about, maybe you talk about BHAGs at this school, a little bit sort of an old Harvard thing. I think the big hairy arsehole, the BHAG, slightly 80s in its expression. But 1 billion trees, he has produced technology that just goes, whammo, trees, woo! I can imagine 1 billion trees. And then think of the scale of your ideas. One of the lectures coming up for D&AD, I've got big architects coming in to see us, because they produce buildings with ski slopes on the top or factories that blow smoke rings. You know, they just manage to do ideas on a scale that when I say, oh, the client wouldn't buy my TV ad, and then I go, did you make a building with a ski slope on it? Like, the scale of what they can sell, I'm fascinated by. The dream of 1 billion trees is amazing. And this is a sad balloon. This is my favorite picture. It's got nothing to do with anything we saw, other than the fact that balloons are supposed to be happy things, and they're very entertaining to me when they're sad. I'm like, come on, balloon. It's the artist Todd Robinson, who just fills balloons with paper mache and makes them sad. See? The best photo you'll take all week. Todd Robinson's sad balloons. Thank you. So the point of that ramble, partly just show you a load of shit that I collected and loved over the past sort of year or so. It's just to say, all of that stuff is creatively driven, where it's reimagining the DNA of a rhino horn, human bodies on chips, the way we engage with trees. It's all technology as creativity. There's no real magic. Any one of us could have had any one of those ideas if we had engaged with technology. Technology is just creative. And we, I'm assuming a lot of you are ad industry, are good at that. Or we used to be. You're getting good at this. You're almost, it's good, thank you. Or we used to be. And I think that the ad industry has lost its confidence. And I think data has something to do with it. And I think the democratization of creativity has something to do with it. We all have an opinion. The internet has taught all of us what to do. There's 1,000,001 blog posts saying you're doing it wrong, which is an awful way to write a blog post, in my opinion. All of this stuff out there teaching us how to be better at what we do, we can read it all. But most of it still has to come from our heart and our gut, says, I love a tree that gets emails that are love letters. That's an emotional response. That's not a rational, I read a blog and I understand how Facebook works response. And so, thank you. This is how the advertising industry has ideas. We get it right, then we get it live. This is a methodology based on creating products that go into small pre-packaged boxes that are then pushed out in broadcast methods. So we create a film and we love on it. We package it, we get the insight right, we polish, we package, we do the post, it's the perfect film, and we launch it and it flies and it crashes because no one cared. Because we didn't, the only testing we did was like four people in a room on a wet Wednesday, and then we looked at them and said, do you like the advertising? And they went, yes. Or we said, what do you think of the advertising? And they went, I've never been told how to talk about advertising at this level. Because we're asking them questions. Like, they're like, can I have a cup of tea and talk about X Factor? It's like, it's ridiculous methodology of asking people strange questions. But so we get it live and it doesn't work. Or we just smash it into people's faces with media. And people don't like us for it. And of course. Like, I'd say, I'd sit there with my mom and she goes, oh, bloody advert. And I'm like, pays my bills, mortgage. And she goes, oh, fair enough, sorry. But, like, we can be so much more useful and entertaining if we actually considered our audiences better or understood how to launch ideas better. So if that's how advertising does it, this is how technology does it. They get it live, then they get it right. So people like to be a bit smug about Google's failures. I think that's their best bit. The fact that they're prepared to put something live early and let it fail and not worry about it. Whether it's Wave or Glass or countless other experiments that they would have done. I think Instagram did not start out as Instagram. Foursquare didn't start out as Foursquare. These products pivot when people start using them. Often a technology company will say, we didn't even know what we were making when we put it live. Until people started using it, then it started to work its own path, its river that it went on. We do not launch ideas like that. Maybe we should start, because we could launch them in beta, watch how people interacted with them, and build on them iteratively. This is really difficult to do. Like, I haven't cracked this at all. But I think if we, the advertising industry, started behaving more like the technology industry, we'd launch more work. That's one of the problems we've got. Too much of our work sits in cupboards with my McDonald's high five. We'd launch more work and better work, and people would engage with our product much more if we followed this methodology. So advertising uses technology to trap ideas. Tech uses technology to release them. So learning five, release early and then work out what the fuck you've done. I think that's a really interesting experimental methodology for our industry. I think if we could just try and do that more, we're all going to enjoy ourselves more and we'll create much better work because of it. Thank you. Meanwhile, here on Earth, advertising, right? We have created a fantasy world the last 20, 30 years. The perfect car, the perfect husband, the perfect life, the perfect skills, the perfect family. It's a fantasy world, right, that we make. We tell stories of want and desire. But our planet is finite. Our advertising is infinite. It's not compatible to keep telling people to have more, to want more on a planet that can't take any more. It's a serious threat to our industry and to our way of life, capitalism. If you're saying more, buy more, buy more, we must keep the cogs turning. And the planet's going, I'm done, people. I'm done and I'm going to fuck you over because you're killing me and you're going to die before I'm going to die. So this fantasy world is a world we want but cannot sustain. But we're not in this world anymore. Because it's the world of Google and tech companies and all those kind of things. Thank you, George. We're in this tech world. But if that was a fantasy world, this is a sci-fi world. It's not true either, as I've shown you. These are just humans who are not afraid of technology. The thing about this world is we're told this is the world we're going to get. Like, this is the technology wave that's going to come and change who humans are. Maybe true, maybe not. But right now, technology technology is our bitch. I was thinking, should I say that? Maybe that's not right. But it is like in that kind of weird American sitcom way. But like technology is there for us to tell us what to do right now. Now, maybe that will change. But I spoke to someone about this a while ago, and he said, well, the theory is we've got one chance to get super intelligence right. Right? If we get it right, we're good. We get it wrong, we're ruined. It's absolutely, the computers are going to be in trouble. But until then, superintelligence is ours to deal with. So this is just a fancy world. What about the real world? Well, where do you start when you look around at the troubles in this world? Whether you're ecology, society, conflict, economy, automation, it's just awash with these troubles. And meanwhile, we're banging out messages saying, hey, get some ice cream. And this is where brand purpose has come along in our industry. I think purpose is the most evil thing the advertising industry has dreamt up, because there's no authenticity underneath it. Maybe with a few brands, purpose stacks up. Most of them, they're saying, we need a brand purpose. I'm like, that's not the point of a purpose. Like, a purpose should hurt you if you go, it's like a principle. It can't just be a thing you use as a brand construct. You can't just make that shit up and expect people to believe you. Very, very kind of evil in a way. But look, the world is in trouble, man. The woods are burning. We've got to start doing something about it. And we have access to brands that has access to culture, that has access to change, if we choose to wield it. Thank you, George. So I was sitting there going, as the president of D&AD, what the hell does that even mean? And I was kind of thinking, maybe not a lot, don't know. And I thought, you know what? I'm gonna write a letter from the office of the president. And I'm going to write the brief of our lives. I think it's singularly the most pompous thing I've ever done in my entire life. And then I put it on the wall in front of you guys. The brief of our lives. We have to design a new way to live on Earth, create a new way to live with each other, and work out how we're going to live with technology. We wrote this on the front of our building the other week, back in London, just as a spark when you walk in the morning. We have to design a new way to live on Earth. I believe that. We can do that as agencies. We have to create new ways to live together. And then we have to work out how the fuck we're going to live with technology. Those are good challenges. Those are the challenges of the modern ad agency, thank you. And the way you do it is you release the idea. You don't have to change what you do. You just have to release it early and experiment. Release the idea. Release the idea means use technology to make new ideas happen. Stand up for what you believe in, right? All this data, all this science telling you what you should do. What do you think you should do? What does your heart, your gut tell you should do? Do that. It's way more powerful. Go against the grain and do what your heart tells you to do. And then release the idea as soon as possible and see what happens. And then bend it and twist it and iterate it and run with it. It's like a child on a training bike, an idea. You're kind of like this, grabbing the wheel. But let it go. Otherwise, people can't engage with it. And if it dies, fuck it, have another one. That's kind of, we have millions of ideas. And answer the brief of our lives. I think you could put a little sprinkle of that brief in any pitch, in any brief that you do, you think, I could just put a little thing in there that just changes the way the world works. Whether it changes the tourist economy in Ecuador, that's a positive influence in an idea. Thank you. And if we do it again and again and again and again and again and again, little time here, little time here, slowly, maybe we start to change the industry, maybe. Just from small waves, big waves can happen. From the wind hits the water and a crashing wave somewhere else in the world, butterfly effect experiment. Watch what happens. Thank you. I think we'd start to create a world we need rather than a world that we want. Last slide. So there we go. Thank you very, very much for listening. Mistakes are important. What you put in your brain matters. It's really okay not to know the answer. Understanding tech on any level changes the type of ideas you can have. And then release those ideas early and work out what the fuck you did. Thank you very, very much.
Since I'm holding the mic, maybe I can ask a question. I'm wondering, in your work at WordCamp or Havas, what has been the experience of engaging technology in the way that you're describing?
The positive experience was we came up with loads of interesting dumb stuff using sort of, I think we were early into wearables, early into using sensors and sort of Internet of Things. We were early into use of APIs. So all of our work, if you look back, it was experimental. The difficulty was maybe it was a little bit small and esoteric, so some people couldn't understand. Maybe it's too complicated because it was loving itself too much. Getting to simplicity with technology is sometimes a challenge. And the other part was, as a business, was cookie cuttering what you did so you could make a profit out of it. Because if you start every new project with a complete fuck it, let's invent something mad, it's really hard to make some money out of that. So like the commercial things of the experimenting were very difficult. But what was great was just the freedom we had to say, well, could we do that? Which is the basis of creativity. Is it possible to do that?
Thank you.
Okay, so I like you to think about
it. I love a question that starts with okay. This is going to be a difficult one. Should I get a drink?
Totally. But, okay, what we can learn from the tech and the startup space, what do you think the startup space and tech specifically could learn from advertising and kind of our traditional?
Yeah, very good question. Flow. Very good question. I think we know an idea when we see it as an industry. And I think the best part of our industry also knows how to affect culture, how to shape an idea. And so when a startup goes through that phase of trying to learn what it is, that's when it needs our thinking. It's how to shape that idea for success. Because we're very good at that, we just do it too early. So we're good at packaging, we're good at shaping, and we're good at making culture when we're at our best. I think just the problem we have actually isn't ideas, it's launching ideas. And so I think what the strengths that we have is maybe getting an idea not born, but maybe alive through that process. I think that's one of them. And then, you know, we're just really good at words and pictures too. You know, those base skills are just a nice turn of phrase, a good name, a nice piece of writing, personality, brand as well. Like a lot of these digital brands, they're bloody weird. Like they're almost despite themselves with their naming and their framing, and that's because, it's because they're cool, they get away with it. So I think I don't advocate, you know, throw out all the old skills. I'd say stand on the shoulders, bring everything you know with you, just bring the other stuff as well and put new stuff in it. So I think digital for years was its worst enemy, own worst enemy. I've worked in digital agencies for years. We were so proud of ourselves for using the internet. We didn't even invent it, we just used it. You know, it's not like it was ours. But we thought we had the answer, we thought we had it, and we were cocky about it. And we felt like traditional methodologies weren't important. It just wasn't the case, actually. Digital is simply the latest innovation to stand on the shoulders of the thousands of others all the way back since man climbed out of a pond. You know, and it all just stacks up. So for me, it's... And this is where I think fear comes from, is that people feel that their skills that they've spent years honing and developing will be superseded by modern technological skills. It's simply not true. The worth you accrue over your career is massive. But if you don't keep it fresh, then it becomes staid and old. And therefore, it's just the individual's responsibility to stay fresh. And then all of that experience is huge.
That was amazing. Thank you. And
thank you.
I couldn't agree more. A lot of what you're saying, the question comes back to the commercial people we were speaking about earlier. I think a lot of advertising people go like and lay in their beds and cry a little because we inherently know exactly what you're talking about. How are you guys getting clients on board? I mean, that's ultimately the thing.
Yep.
How do you commercialize this? And not only that, get them to believe that brand purpose is potentially commercial if you don't believe in it and actually live it.
Yeah.
How are those conversations going to work?
Well, do you know with... It's a real challenge. With Work Club, it was interesting because we were able to just spin off and kind of tell internet stories. And they would all look at us saying, oh, this is nice. But then the revenue streams are all over here. And when the pinch came, a recession, they said, just cut off all that innovation stuff and we'll sell some stuff. And so we were never having the right conversations. And so I think it's... My truthful answer is I don't know. At Havas, we're trying to do now is build ourselves around the client in that way. So be a much more fluid, agile service. So no one's going to buy us for this thing that we do. You will buy us for what we can do for you. And so it's a much more open and collaborative methodology that allows us to get to the right answers for that right client. So I think it begins there. And then my other hope is, I think Facebook won, right? It kind of killed all the internet experimentation. And if I was a marketeer, I'd be pretty happy about that because my life got a bit easier, because it was getting a bit difficult, to be honest. If I was like a CMO of a brand, this plethora of new media, everyone trying to sell me the future, expensive e-commerce platforms that are outdated 6 months later. You got to put your site in Instagram. I don't want to, you know, all this kind of stuff is noisy and difficult. And suddenly I realized I could make a great tele ad, cut it up in lots of different ways, remix it and put it in Facebook, probably do a pretty good marketing job. And so there's a normalization in digital that's happened a little bit. My hope is that that will open up a channel of innovation again, because that normalization means we're all doing the same thing. It's comfortable. Here is some opportunity to experiment. And that's where the opportunity lies for me, is go back to this principle of saying, bet a little bit on small iterative experiments. Whereas what digital used to do was say, bet a fuckload on big, sexy experiments. Don't do that. That's going to hurt. And so I think it's small experiments often would be the pithy sentence I wish I got to at the start of the long rambling answer.
Thank you very much. That was really, really interesting.
Thank you.
I think the biggest challenge that we face is that we live in a world, I guess, in our industry, where we reassure our clients on how much we know, how much we've gained, and why it's a good risk to go with us. But I think we learned today about the power of the unknown, the constraint of unknown, and how it encourages creativity. What would be your recommendation in literally seeing the storm that it's okay to go around saying, I don't know?
I think try it. Just say it to your client and see what they'll probably breathe a sigh of relief. You'll probably be the most refreshing person in the room if you said it. I don't know. I've done it once in a pitch where the client asked me an absolute stinger of a question. I just went, I don't know. I know a man who does. He's going to write to you in 20 minutes with the answer. And I phoned up my producer and I said, this is the question. I need an answer in 20 minutes. Here's the guy's email. Do it, please. Guy got his email. He loved it. Loved it. Because there was an honesty that said, look, I'm not omnipotent here. Or I'm not omnipresent. But I know lots of people with lots of different answers. And it's that collaboration point. Is you can't, it's a bit with creativity. If I say, hey, here's a good idea, and you tell me that's a crap idea, that's dead. Nothing's going to happen here. Unless you know it's now your responsibility to have a good idea, because you said no to my idea. And that's how ideas build. You say, no, it's not good, but what if we did this? And I might go, oh, yeah, that's good, but what about this? And you go, no, that's no good. What about this? And so you build. And by saying, I don't know, you then put the responsibility on yourself for finding out. Like, I don't know is not like, I don't know, I don't care. It's, I don't know, but I want to find out. And so I think that's maybe the build. And then certainly with clients, I think it has to be what we can do for you, not really what we have said we have done. And so I don't know. I mean, have clients lost confidence in ad agencies is a really important question to try and ask and answer. I think there is a bit of a confidence problem going around. But mostly, there is no one answer. That's the thing. Maybe there used to be a silver bullet in this industry, but there isn't anymore. There's many ways to solve this problem. So who are you going to partner with to solve it best? That's what a client should be asking, in my opinion. When you look these people in the eye, are they up for it? Do they want the fight? Do they have ideas? Are they positive? Are they interested? Are they humble? Are they human? Could you spend 5 hours on a train with them without throttling them? These are the important questions, actually. Not really. Have they written enough blog posts about SEO? Or did they do a load of advertising that was great last year? It's about human collaboration and relationships.
I've been looking at your learnings in that and really thinking about mistakes are important, release the idea early, all that stuff. I think it's really great. How do you reconcile that, though, with don't fuck it up?
Well, easy. I got this one. I thought about this one a lot. But see, as I was saying at the start, don't fuck it up for me is, there's a phrase called break a leg in English, I think, which is you say in the theatre when someone's about to go on stage, you say break a leg. and it means good luck. But there's a phrase, it's called gallows humor. It's like black humor. And I've really liked it. It's like a Northern English sarcasm thing that I really like. And don't fuck it up is that. You kind of look at it and you go, what? That's a bit weird. But what it's saying is have something in your work that is dangerous. An element that is incendiary in your work, that is edgy, that is interesting. Because without it, your work is dull. You need something that's a little bit wrong or a little bit buzzy or a little bit angry or a little bit dangerous. That's where you'll get your bite for your creator. And you know it because it's in here. And you feel it. When you come up with a good idea, you watch people, they go, you know, there's that human reaction to a good idea where people start going like this and get a little excited. You watch a pitch, 2 a.m, where the idea is shit and someone suddenly says something, it turns on, the whole room lifts the energy of an idea. You've got to have that. Don't fuck that up. That's what it means. Like, but you've got to have it. And if you've got that, take care of it. Protect it. Nurture it. Grow it. Launch it. And so it's thought through to be as provocative as it is. But the truth in it is very hard to argue against. Because without that element, you've got nothing. You've got not got any interest in work. And drop that, it's a failure. So it actually says, look after the dangerous thing in a nice way. I've got a blog post about it. I'll send it you. Are we there? Any more for any more?
I feel that we very often generalize the situation in advertising. Like advertising has lost its confidence. I mean, we together can name 20 agencies that are doing brilliant work, that are building business, that are doing work that is respectable, that is intelligent, that engages in a way we would love to see the advertising. So advertising has lost its confidence. Probably what happened was that 80% of the work we know, which is kind of cliched, or I mean we wonder why it exists, sort of is partly eliminated and moves into digital. And in digital, when I look at digital, I mean, I can also name 20 agencies that are doing fantastic work, that are doing work, that have built the Uniqlo thing with the UniClock, mm-hmm. or let's take the Ice Bucket Challenge, or what? You know, there's not a lot that I see that has ever built a brand.
Exactly.
Unless it's a technology brand like Airbnb or Uber or this sort of thing.
Neither of those used advertising. Yeah. Uber's never needed to advertise at all.
Right.
The product does the advertising.
Yeah. That's right. But you know, massive money now moves into digital, you know, and they are producing stuff like a piece of work you have seen where people that never met before, they kiss each other.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Who did it? You don't know.
Exactly.
I mean, probably a lot of people don't know, but 200 million might have seen it.
Yep.
You know? And that is, I think, digital in a way has become also what was bad advertising before.
Mm. So lack of appropriation.
It just moved over.
Yeah.
But some people are doing fantastic work.
They are.
Yes.
They are.
Yeah? And it is probably those people that really understand tech on any level. Your point number 4,
yeah.
Like RGA or,
yeah.
You know, I mean, some others.
Yeah.
You can name. So there is a lot of stuff. I mean, when for instance, I think about content. I mean, what the hell is content? I mean, content always had to be there to build a brand. And if it was a print ad or whatever, you had to have a content.
Oh, yeah, also, do I watch House of Cards or do I watch your advert?
Yeah.
I watch House of Cards, thanks. You know, like, it's a challenge. I think you're absolutely right, it's a generalization. And I'm not sure I can do a talk without generalizations. You kind of have to provoke. But the interesting thing in it is I feel that the nature of technology is putting our gut feel. That when I talk about confidence, it's the confidence of an individual to say, this is what I want to do. I think I'm right, and to take a risk. And I think that data proving that that's not the way to do it chips away at your confidence. Lots of other people telling you, no, I wouldn't do it like that, chips away at your confidence. The threat of recession, meaning that risks are not quite as acceptable as they were, chips away at your confidence. So it seems to me that a lot of the pressures on the advertising industry aren't really cognizant to great creativity. They chip away and damage an idea. And an idea starts as a bright, burning ball of possibility and then pops out the other end like a dead stone after it's been chipped along in the process. Because we're so demanding of creating the perfect idea that we must make it perfect all the way through the creative process. It pops out at the end. So I think you're right, there are a lot of agencies doing wonderful work, and I'm jealous of every single one of them. It's fantastic stuff. But I think in general, technology is having a poor effect on advertising because of the way we use it and the way we're allowing it to affect the humanity in advertising, which I think if you looked at every one of these 20 agencies, they will be companies that understand this is just humans talking to humans. I think at the end of it, and they understand technology is simply a way to do with that. The other point I think you raise is really interesting, and this is what I'm trying to do with my company at the moment, which is really difficult. I don't want 1-9, I want 27s, if that makes sense. So a 9 as in a brilliant, that's 9 out of 10. I'm not looking for that at the moment. I'm looking for consistent 7 out of 10, 7 out of 10, 7 out of 10, all the way across. And then from that baseline, I want to go 7, 7, 8, 7, 7, 8, 9, 7, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 9, 9, 9. And I want to hit a run, like Roger Federer. I want to hit a run for 2 years when I just smack 9, 9, 9, 9. And then I'll go off the boil, because that's how it works in life. And then I'll come down and I will sit down and I'll go, man, that was fucking good. But that's what I'm trying to do. So I'm not interested in 1-9. I am, that would be nice. I'm interested in 5 or 6 of the fuckers in a line. And so I think that's the way, in my mind, you build a creative department. Because you can't just bash people and say, give me 9s. You've got to build.
I mean, you turn it around. You want to eliminate the 5s and the 4s and the 3s.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, that is, if you're a chief creative officer, if we are leading a company, we don't want to be, we want to avoid these inferior things that might be practical, maybe the finance guy says, sell something. I mean, you work too many hours on it. Get it out.
Yep.
So I mean, I don't know how it happens.
Yep.
Maybe most of the great stuff happens because the great people, they work overnight more often.
And I think there was trust. I think most of the great stuff happens because there was trust in someone who had an idea that they would nurture that idea to the right place. And then maybe there was trust that when that idea didn't work, they fixed it. Like we put a piece of work live a few years ago, we thought it would fly. We launched it, it didn't go anywhere. It was just a viral piece. Did not go anywhere. And we thought, hang on a minute, we're tattooing some bloke in a parlor with a QR code and a mobile phone. This is kind of weird. It's got loads of subculture in it. It should get picked up. Didn't get picked up. And we were sitting there straight after watching it, didn't go. And we were like, all right, recut it. So the next day we recut it because it was cut short and fast. Next day we cut it longer. It was 3 times as long. It went boom, took off. And it was simply storytelling. To this question about what skills we have, we got the storytelling wrong. People didn't understand it. As soon as we recut the film and redid it, it got its views. And it wasn't buying them all kind of viral. And it was just because we looked at it and said, fuck, this is wrong. We got to redo it. And the client loved it. We just rolled up our sleeves, recut it, straight through the night, put it live again, solved the problem.
I'm not from the advertising industry. I'm more from the finance industry.
Excellent.
Now, but from what I understand, for many years, a company like Havas, you would do the creative, you would also help in the targeting, i.e. the demographics, and you would also then buy the advertising, so your buying department. So you would offer 3 services in one.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with technology, you have specialized ad networks who I work a lot with, who do the placing effectively for you or for your client.
Yep.
They know through which website or through which app they can target which customer through banner ads or brand campaigns online, etc. At the same time, you have real-time bidding all over the place in digital media. So to some extent, the traditional agencies, I would think, have lost a bit of the revenue potential because you have all these new players who on the one side do the media placement for them, and the other side also the targeting. So how do you, I don't know if you can generalize, but how do you feel about the new balance of power between the agencies and the different players in this ecosystem, because now you have so much more than you had before?
I welcome the wolf at my door, because it makes life more interesting, I think. So for me, it's fascinating to look at how these new media companies and new tech companies are challenging the way you can have ideas. I don't think anything that you are mentioning prohibits me from using their platforms to have ideas. I think I can take all of that automatum or programmatic or all of those values, and I can use those systems to tell the stories that I want to tell. So I don't think it's an... what's the word I want? I don't think they're mutually exclusive. I think they work together. Certainly when you're talking about media, the way ideas flow. If your point is that the programmatic or the technology can start to say, here is the right idea at the right time in the right place, that to me sounds like hell on earth for a customer to constantly be being a robot assuming it's got the right idea. Like, I scream at YouTube for fucking dog food ads. It makes me watch dog food. I don't have a dog. And I'm sitting there watching dog food ads, and I'm just like, it should know better. You know, bad dog. But none of it's all valueless without an idea that is worth engaging with. It's all just noise. And all I have to do to turn any of this stuff off is put my ad blocker on. And I don't see any of that amazing technology. I've just turned it off. And why wouldn't you, as a consumer, turn it off? And then you look at all the stuff that this runs on, all these websites who've allowed the web to look like this because they make money off it. It's a challenge. So first of all, I think more technology, please, more for me to play with as a creative to tell stories through it. Secondly, it's all valueless without a good idea that people actually care about. And that still is the soul of an advertising agency and should remain as such. Is the ability to articulate a culturally positive idea and put it out into a marketplace by whatever means is most appropriate.
Thanks.
Like, I can't even get home, so like, I'm here for the night. We could go all night. Hello.
Hello, Alex.
Hey.
Thank you for your talk.
You're very welcome.
A question maybe about your everyday life and everyday work here in the company. You speak about innovation. What kind of technologies you use, what kind of culture you have in your own company to work on innovation? It means like ideas made after request, the pitch, are almost like focused. Well, I have this theme or whatever. But there are also technology innovations which are not able to be proved and sold in this moment. Do we have an R&D? Do we have a kind of laboratory or something? Is there something
just this?
Back?
Just my own head, yeah. No, we've never had that. And I think maybe because Work Club was a lab. So a lab in Work Club would have been kind of, I don't know, slightly metaphysically strange because it was in itself an innovation lab, I think. Now I'm in a bigger network. I still don't see the need for a lab because we can all behave with that character. I want the whole company to behave with innovation But innovation is a funny word. It's been kind of ridden over by the advertising industry as something bigger than it needs to be. I think everything is innovation. Everything moving, every new idea, every push should be innovative and interesting. So I think everyone is capable of that, just like everyone is capable of an idea. So for me, I'm not a big exponent of a lab, because I think what it does is it makes it someone else's problem. And so I'm a creative in an ad agency. They're the creatives in the lab of the ad agency. They do it. I don't have to. And so what I do is I get lazy. I keep doing what I've done. And then I look over there and I say, maybe they could answer this question. Or I go over there like this saying, I don't know what to do with this. Maybe you could do something. And they look at me and go, well, they bring this stuff over to me and say, hey, why didn't you do something like that? And you go, client, I'll never buy that, which because you don't understand it. So for me, a lab in our industry ostracizes the problem rather than embraces it. I'd much rather embrace it. I didn't even know that answer before I said it. You have learned something there. That's a good question. Thank you.
The idea behind this question was like, if I'm asked by a client to do something like completely new, and I'm able to convince a client that we are work on it, and I'm explaining them that we have to open up some experiments,
yep,
that we have to test things,
yep,
and we don't know to really know if they are successful,
yep,
because we want to test them.
Yep.
So we have also to speak about the budget,
yep,
and also about the, I have to explain how,
yep,
the budget comes, because there are people working in a lab,
right,
because they don't want to offer for free.
Yep.
So that's what, like, also the behind question, how I explain to a client that we have to do experiments,
yep,
and see what will happen.
I think you can, well, we do, every idea is an experiment in a sense. It's all creative and made up, and it's on a process, bizarrely against the time clock, which is very strange. So for me, I'm comfortable with it. But I think you may be, the classic is trying to get the client to assign some budget. What the technology industry does is sprints. So it runs in short bursts at the problem, and then it shares very quickly with the client. So bring the client in daily if you have to. Sit with them every 24 hours and go, this is where we're at, this is what we learned, this is where we're going. Do a sprint, stop, package, talk. Sprint again, stop, package, talk. So it's simply a change of process that you're talking about. To agile, to borrow from technology a process. So we've just moved, or in the process of moving, our whole company onto Slack. So they start to think more like a tech business rather than an email-driven business. That will just get them sprinting, get them working in these new processes. And those processes are uncomfortable for people because they've worked a different way for a long time. But if you start working in sprints and bursts and betas and tests, you'll start experimenting. And the client, I'll have a great time because they're right in the middle of it. Thank you very, very much. I think we'll be done. Thank you.
I think we are through. And I think we all got inspired by one simple fact. In order to lead something, you have to have ideas and a program how to do it. And I think we clearly got that from you. And I think here and there, we got also inspired and learned something.
Good.
What we have maybe overlooked or will adapt. Huh? So, and the other wonderful thing is that we still have you tomorrow.
That's true.
Yeah, that is fantastic. And now we want to take you to a place we don't have any LSD.
He says that now. You know, see what in those
maybe
pockets.
Maybe we can get a glass of wine.
Wonderful.
Into your body. Huh? Okay. Thanks, Andy.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Your pleasure.